IIT Women in Engineering faculty today, and a special note goes out to Dr. Ekta Singla, Dr. Neha Sardana, and Dr. Kushbu Raka. And they have led the fight against COVID, and they'll tell us a little bit about their work today. So without further ado, I'll turn this over to Sunaina. And again, welcome you all to the webinar today. We hope you enjoy it. And please stay in touch with SWE. And if you have any questions, please contact us and we'll be more than happy to work with you. Thank you very much.
Nana, you are muted.
Thank you. Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So I'm going to quickly announce a few SWE updates and online resources. So we encourage you to apply to our Global Ambassador Program, which is a one-year-long program where you can serve a leadership role, both locally as well as globally, where SWE members experience talking to all the global members as well as impacting young girls to get interested in STEM. So if you are interested to apply for this program, do apply using the link available, as well as it will be sent to you in your follow-up mail. And also don't forget to apply before 30th June. Another one is our online career center, where you can build your resume as well as search opportunities with our partner companies who support SWE goals to uplift women, be part of STEM fields and in leadership roles. Another great online resource from SWE is Advanced Learning Center, where we'll be updating ongoing webinars and e-learning courses. Do check it out if you like learning new resources online from the website advancedlearning.swe.org. For more information on our programs and initiatives, do visit our website swe.org or contact us at info_india@swe.org. Once again, thank you for registering and making your time for the webinar. We going forward, today's webinar is hosted by IIT Roper affiliate on using tech for good during the pandemic. The speakers will be covering a wide range of topics, from applications of robotics and adapting ventilators to developing sanitizing equipment during this pandemic, especially our nationwide lockdown in India, which most of us have experienced. Quickly, I'm going to introduce the speakers. Today's first presentation will be by Dr. Ekta Singla. She's presently serving as an associate professor and head of mechanical engineering at IIT Roper, with research interests in modular robotics for Industry 4.0, service robotics, rehabilitation, and assistive devices. She's also a recipient of a national award from Institute of Engineers, Institute Gold Medal, National Doctoral Fellowship, and CNRS Postdoctoral Fellowship for UPMC Paris. To enhance training and learning environment of industrial robotics field, she planned and executed an MOU signed between IIT Roper and Tata Automation to establish robotics research and training center at IIT Roper. Also, she established a platform called Punch Robotics to focus on academic, professional, and innovation related activities, not only at IIT Roper, but also to connect many institutes. To know more about it, you can check it out at punjrobotics.com. The second presentation will be by Dr. Neha Sardana, who is an assistant professor in Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering, IIT Roper. She is a PhD from International Max Planck Research School for Science and Technology of Nanostructures, Germany. She previously served as a scientist at Institute of Nanoscience and Technology and as well as an assistant professor at IIT Jodhpur. The third presentation is by Dr. Kushbu Raka, presently serving as an assistant professor in the Department of Metallurgical and Materials Engineering, IIT Roper. She is a PhD from Deakin University, Australia. She studied BTech in Metallurgical and Material engineering at IIT Roorkee. Her areas of research are advanced high-strength steels and atom probe tomography. So one more guideline is, if you have any questions during the presentation, do add in your questions in the Q&A section. We'll be addressing it in the last 15 minutes of the webinar. And over to Dr. Ekta.
Thank you. So thank you, Sunaina. I'll be sharing it now. I hope this is visible, the presentation, please. If my screen is now visible, Sunaina?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. And I thank you, Sunaina, for this small introduction, as well as the entire wonderful Society of Women Engineers, who is, I know the entire environment is very active. And of course, this IIT affiliate, which is very proudly, I would say, that I am not the one who is associated or actually into hosting, but it is actually, I would like to sincerely acknowledge and appreciate the efforts from Dr. Asad and Subodh, who are really helping the SWES affiliates to get established at IIT. Also, not only this organization, but their continuous efforts for industry and academia connect. So with this, now focus for today is tech for good. And in that, in the last 2 to 3 months, we have been giving this small attempt, which I would like to contribute, share you this contribution, small contribution, which we had tried in last, since I would say April 2020. And of course, it is associated to our recent issues and which is all around us. And if I take you back all to March and April, when suddenly we got to know about what, first of all, pandemics are and where we have, where this entire change has happened. So in totality, all the campaign, all the guidelines were coming regarding to the keyword, and that was social distancing. Although there were campaigns, there were protocols, but what exactly was missing, because this small presentation is all about the fields where it cannot be avoided. It is not avoidable. The challenges lie there, because when I'm talking about April, when the span is very small, this 2 or 3 months, but we had witnessed how fast we have seen the changes. And during that, in the very beginning, during April, we could see that the first kind of such example of the challenges where it was very difficult to avoid such social distancing was the interaction, first of all, with the health workers. Because, this is something, first, all the health workers, particularly the frontline workers, they need to interact with patients, they need to serve them food, medicine. In fact, it was far more times a day. So while associating to some of the hospitals, during April, it was sitting at home with our other works, it was good for us. It was rather, it became very important that whatever language we know, whatever tools we know, can be helped in some way. And because I was associated to, in the last 15 years working into the robotics field, so we started looking for any of such solutions, which may not be, these advanced technologies, but something which can be helpful. Because all these news, if you just see, remember, it is not related to only the physical health problems of the workers, but their mental pressure too. And the keywords, as I had just shown in the slide, is about the frontline workers. So with all these news, we started thinking of that, what if we can actually contribute? And I'm sure like-minded people were also thinking the similar strategies. Apart from that, this is one example. Another such examples comes from the delivery. This is again essential item, but that is why I mentioned it was not avoidable. It is something where we know that unwillingly we need to allow the delivery boys towards the apartment, particularly the societies and the apartments. All these news, again, were just pointing out to the main challenge, and that is how there had been panic. And can we now, if the time has come, to look for some technologies which can be utilized, you know, at least as I have mentioned, for the help of leaving the parcels at the gate, because I'm talking about particularly the apartments where you will prefer that just for delivery at one or two houses or one or two flats, the entire the interaction of that those particular delivery person should not be there with the entire society. So basically it was all pointing out to some help or some assistance from the technology, and different direction solutions were coming during April and May. And third such example, or I would say the direction with the field where we had to pay attention both during the pandemic, I mean this lockdown, and even after, is regarding our offices. Although we can say that for the time being people were working from home, but even after the lockdown, it was important to look for some ways, because just if you see that the idea is that we all these latest these protocols which we are receiving may be from the government or even from our official, because I also do belong to an academic institute that to government, so we know that the entire paperwork will be back and we cannot just shift very soon to everything as e-working, right? So with that exchange of documents, don't we think that it will be very impractical to talk about just washing our hands in 20 minutes or some another such protocols, and it will be better that we use some technology in that direction. So keeping such kind of challenges and such different areas where can be looked for. So I think in the very beginning, I'll show you this particular video which we had given. So it will take around just less than a minute. And this is what we proposed during April, and we are working on this particular solution. So please have a look. So here we have given the robotic assistance as the name BotBot, which is actually an autonomous system rather than only a remote control. We look for, can we develop such system? Yes. So this is something as I have mentioned, that this is regarding how to the name was also depicting the same, that rather than a ward boy in a health system, can we look for assistance from the robotic assistants, and so as to first look for this keyword social distancing to be implemented at such locations. So with this, as I said, that now the solution from our end, as during the same time, like-minded people have also given some similar solutions, and I will be just taking just showing you even those, like how technology has helped us. And in fact, I would like to share for a moment with you the why I was really glad, because I'm working into robotics since long, and I know that in our industry, even defense, there had been similar technology already in use. But then how to bring that? It was, we were thinking that it will be, you know, very long to look for robotics in our societies or in our, like bringing the automation to the mass. But I was glad to see that how fast it is now coming up, and how we can see that it is not really expensive, and we can use, we can look for such systems, because this is just the pictures in the same, as I said, just demonstrating that how a robotic system may help to deliver the, you know, to exchange the files or for delivery things or even for helping in the hospitals. So this is kind of a customized solution which can be into in different forms. This is just a picture that which is like depicting the same robotic system. And now, because as I said, during the same times, you might have noted, it was glad to know that from our, because I am taking the examples all from, I would say, indigenous, because globally there are many of such robotic systems which are taking into account. But just to show you a glimpse, because the time was short, so what I tried is just to put them in two types. So you will see that solutions which have been reported can be mentioned in two types. So first is the human-like structure. So all these which you can see now at my slide is just some examples. I'll be sorry for some of the ones if I've missed, because these are just my collection. So one is like this Jaipur-based company. I remember how it is already into use. And another, this from SEMO. This is again from Kochi-based and Kerala. And then this software company, because all these from Trichy. And finally, we know that. So finally, this is all related to Milagro. I know Milagro is one of the firms which is making the robotic systems mainly for the home appliances for cleaning. Since long, I do have it in my labs, and it was very good to see their robotic systems come into market and already into use by AIIMS Delhi and some other hospitals probably. But only thing is that why we still think that we need some another kind of structures, because you will see all these are having one common thing, and that is the structure is human-like. So yeah, it is aesthetically very nice and probably very good for the for a feeling good factor of the in hospitals, particularly for the patients. But sometimes I feel that utility will be more if we can serve more patients at one point of time, and then aesthetics is not that important in India. And secondly, like less payload capacity, because I could see that in general, it's not that I do have the data for all these things, but I can say that overall the payload capacity or the ratio, payload ratio will be less in these structures, and they will be designed only for serving one person at a time. So that's why the proposed solution which we are working on is actually a balanced structure, which is inherently balanced. It's designed in that way. And certainly for the uneven grounds, because we know we have to look for the, because all these ideas, you know, are coming from the hospitals themselves, because when we discuss with them, they feel that, you know, you're talking about robots, but will they really work on our floors? So we have to look for such practical points. Second type is this trolley structure you might have noted. I'm sure all these are in our news since last one or two months. And for example, I think this I have written wrong, it's not Jaipur based, but I've seen this cobot coming into the hospital, and how we have seen that remote controlled such solutions are being used already. And this is from CMERI Durgapur, and I got to know that it's very, as I already mentioned, it is good to see all these solutions learning from each other. And this Indian Railway, you might have seen the Arjun, the name has been given, and how now the similarity in this is that all of these are remote controlled trolley structures, right? Some may be semi-autonomous, but I would like to say that their utility again is good. I think they are easy to make, and converting the existing trolleys into the simple automation, right? But I would say it has some limited utility, because as far as serving the medicines or where you would like, interaction should not be there. So serving multiple person may not be very, it cannot be no contact, like contact free, because still it will be serving and the same, all the people will be using the same trolley. Apart from that, as I said, that the way we are utilizing the structure, we are utilizing the entire body, as well as taking how much space we are taking, all those things may better be designed. So I would say a trade-off was required between this as well as the other solution. So that's how I said the proposed solution is actually tested over the impact loading, because of course against the fall, avoiding, if it can avoid fall, if there is a small jerk, right? So all these design-oriented analysis was done. And I would like to say that in our case, we thank the are one of some help even from SolidWorks. So this is just like now pointing out to whatever I mentioned, that our design which we are working on, right, is all for serving multiple patients. That is why you will see it is a balanced structure, and we can add as many features and distinct hospital wards can be given, because you will see, as already in the picture, in all the video, you might have noticed, and that it will actually, it is an autonomous system where a patient ID will be, which can be displayed if it is reaching to the patient, and how it will be helpful to just for distinct locations, and it can reach itself because it will be, all the path can be planned according to the hospital. And another point which our partners, because we are also working these days with CMERI Ludhiana, so as to get it fabricated, because sitting at home, it was quite difficult to get the components and then get it made in a proper way. But nowadays, I think it is almost ready, which I could not show presently. But it is all that they also like the particular point about this design, which is modular in nature, because it's, you know, you can very well see that its structure is, it can be packed also in a very compact way, as well as while fabricating, it can be used because it's very symmetric, and even the fabrication or the manufacturing is easy to do. Right, so we can see that it, one, even if it will be customized, but the cost can be reduced to a good point. So in totality, this is kind of a balanced structure to serve more people, and also because of its structure, the payload capacity is quite higher. Right, and these are some of the another features, and I'm not going into details of it because, you know, these electronics features can be added as many as we like. It can be all customized according to the requirement, because for example, this patient, if how the patient will get to know that he or she has taken the food or medicine, then there is a gesture sensor. So all these new sensors can be used to make it better featured, or as per the requirement of, because we are not working for one environment. I said it is something which can be customized according to the different situations. So this is just quickly, I just show you that how it was encouraging to have some of the feedback through news and through some of the media channels. So basically, I would say that more than publicity, it was helpful by sharing with others that how more features and how it is being used, you know, it is kind of an invited gesture from the society that yes, they are looking for such solutions. So that is always encouraging. And yes, I would like to see that, say that this is something which, because anyway, we were working on it. So there was a, in the last, you know, 2 months already, to encourage the entire nation, even government is looking for, is opening many challenges. So we also participated, and this particular entry was taken up in, this was one of the top 10 in the 2500 or plus entries in the Samadhan, which was actually giving some concept for how we can actually help during this pandemic. So this I can proudly say, and rather I would like to say that I am debited to this team of mine, which is all my, all the different students, particularly they are associated to the robotic club at IIT Roper. And we all, I showed this picture because this is all that we were working at our homes, and I told them that let's connect our pictures, and how we were connecting particularly between 12 to 2 in the night after all our other online works. I was preparing lectures, they were attending lectures, and how they actually helped to give this particular solution. And we are already working, and I would say this, I would acknowledge finally to the CSIR CMERI who had helped us, because we tried with different industries, and finally we are working with CMERI, the government organization, which for the fabrication of this particular robotic system. So I hope very soon we'll be able to show the proof of concept. And with this, I thank you all, and I hope I have not taken much time, but maybe a little more. And this is just a contact in case it is somebody would like to even see later. Punch Robotics is already mentioned in the beginning. Thank you. So that is all in case.
Thank you, Ekta. Thank you for introducing us to such a beautiful robotic concept to maintain social distancing in workplaces, especially where social workers are working. Next, we are going on to Dr. Neha Sardana to present her presentation.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. You're able to see my screen?
Not yet.
Okay, so welcome everyone. So I'll be talking on some technologies that our group has developed to empower the combat of SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19. So before I directly dive into the concept of technologies, we can say technologies are usually evolved when there is a need from public or when we see our nature around and we get inspired from it. Also, there are movies that we can get inspired from, and sometimes the movies get inspired from us. So I was just recommended during this lockdown, you should see this movie Contagion. It's a 2011 movie, I think around a decade old, and it has the exact same concept as COVID-19. So they use masks, gloves, PPEs, they use social distancing, they use quarantine methodologies to separate those who are sick from those who are healthy. And then in the center, you can see there is an innovative tech there. They are wearing these head masks. And in this movie also, there is a transfer from bat to pig to humans, and then eventually from humans to humans. In this movie, which is a real thing, Kate Winslet says that an average person touches their face between 2,000 to 3,000 times a day. Well, is this real? Well, in real terms, and on an average, a person touches their face about 16 times an hour. That comes up to 256 times if you're awake for 16 hours. Some people might touch their faces less than it, and sometimes some people might touch their faces more than it. So this is about the movie and how it can be related from the real life in current scenario. So when we are talking about COVID-19, we are talking about a novel coronavirus. So what are its features? If we want to develop any technology, we should know what are we combating. So when we talk about COVID-19, the diameter of this.
Yeah. Neha, just a minute. We cannot see your presentation. Did you share it yet?
I shared my screen. I have shared it. See, now are you able to see?
Yes, yes, we can. Thank you.
Then the whole excitement part is over. I should repeat it. Now, can you see? What are you able to see? You're able to see the slide?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Just a second. Let me go back to the movie slide. So this was the movie, and I was talking about it regarding Kate and how it is related. And this is the innovative tech that I was talking about with the PPE, and he's having an air respirator connected to himself. And they're following the social distancing, and then they're wearing masks, gloves, etc. So I was talking about how technologies can be used in this case. Just a second. So virus size is very important if we want to have any technology to combat such a virus. So the diameter of SARS-CoV-2 is around 100 nanometers, and its volume is around 10 to the power 6 nanometer cube, and its mass is 10 to the power 3 megadalton. So when we talk about virus, this is a quite big virus. It's not a small virus, which is around 1 to 2 nanometers. And it is not a light virus, which can be transmitted to larger distances. We know that it has an inner RNA and it has a spike protein outside. So when a person is infected from this particular virus, its size and its droplets come through our respiratory tract outside, and the droplets containing the virus are of the size of 5 microns. And we know about the symptoms of an infected person. We also know that it has been a zoonotic transfer, that is, it has been transferred from an animal to humans and then humans to humans. We also know that its transmission has been through mouth, nose, and eyes of an infected person. Still, research is going on to see whether there is a transmission through water, air, water, or feces. Furthermore, WHO has also told that the virus can survive on different surfaces up to 72 hours on plastic, 24 hours on cardboard, and 4 hours on copper. Well, there are still not complete studies. Some studies do say that the virus can survive up to 9 days on a plastic or steel surface. So still there is a lot of contradictory statements going on here. And that is why it is novel, because we have not faced such a thing before. So how can we tackle something which is like novel coronavirus? So we can go through 5 different routes. We can have a protective, that is, we can defend, guard, or prevent any harm that is coming from it, from an infected person to us. We can take preventive measures to stop or keep the harm from coming. We can trace the patients which are infected, and we can test these patients through different methods, and finally, we can treat them. So, is prevention better than cure when we talk about novel coronavirus? Well, I personally think that protection and prevention is better than cure in current terms, until and unless a vaccine or a drug has been defined to completely cure us. So prevention and protection from transmission is through hand hygiene, gloves, goggles, masks, and there is a lot of research on nanoparticles which can kill these virus particles, or at least disembark the spike proteins that are outside the COVID-19 viron. Of course, people are using environmental sterilization techniques. So where is the innovation that is required during the prevention and protection? There is a lot of material innovation that is required. We need breathable fabrics, because doctors wear these PPEs and it is very difficult to keep wearing them for more than 6 hours. It is very difficult to breathe, and the doctors are completely sweating. Especially in countries like India, it is quite hot and humid. And we know the size of virus is around 100 nanometers. So we can have fabrics with a pore size which are less than this particular size, so it is breathable for the doctors. Then we also know that there has been contamination from one medical personnel to the other. So it is good if we can have self-cleaning gloves or antiviral surfaces where any infection that travels from the person who is infected to any such surfaces is not carried on to a healthy human being. Of course, there is a lot of design and innovation required at the manufacturing units for these PPEs, PPE designs, so that the doctors, the WHO usually says you need a buddy while removing your PPEs. And at times, because of this guideline from WHO, many doctors have been infected. And so we are looking into, our group is also looking into PPE designs which can be easily removed, and they can be infection free and self-sterilizing. I think Dr. Khushbu will talk about it more. So we need sterilization technologies. We need automation where there is non-contact mode, as Dr. Ekta has already discussed. And another important feature is waste disposal. So waste is also being created a lot with these PPEs. If anyone is using a glove or mask or goggles, it has to be disposed of. And being plastic based or non-biodegradable, these are unable to be processed, and waste disposal is getting difficult and difficult. So from India's perspective, there is a lot of work that is going on tracing, testing, and treating. We are having a lot of detection kits which are based on nucleic acid tests and antibody tests. Till now, world has accepted the nucleic acid test, and PCR based studies are going on. And antibody tests are coming up, and they are much faster and quicker. And serological tests are also coming out. There is a lot of research that is going on drug testing, drug delivery, novel therapeutics, and immune response studies. So the point here is all our biotechnologists, all our doctors, all our medical professionals and experts are continuously working on these three techniques. From a perspective of India, any technology that is being developed has to be scalable for such large populations as in India. It should be easy to use for general public or for a less skilled worker. There should be precision in testing. That is, if someone is COVID positive, the results should always come as positive so as to contain the spread of this disease. Furthermore, these technologies, they need to be economical. That is, they should have low cost per unit per person, and it should be easily accessible to rural areas. They should be sustainable, either biodegradable or reusable to avoid another kind of contaminations. So our group has been trying their best to give solutions. So these are my research scholars who have been working throughout the lockdown period while they are at home and making prototypes. So we have made these different solutions. So we'll talk about few of them. So we were discussing, one of my students, Gaurav, and I were discussing that COVID-19 has created a lot of shortage of ventilators. So he said, I want to do something on ventilators, man. And I said, let's look into the numbers first and then decide whether we should go with ventilators. And then we read more about COVID-19 and we saw that only 15% of the cases require hospitalization. And less than 5% of them require mechanical ventilation. So we were discussing and we came up with the idea, let's talk about reducing the cost of existing CPAP and BiPAP machines. Is it possible that we can reduce and we can have a larger impact for people who are not so serious and do not need hospitalization? But even if they go to hospitals, they should be able to get an oxygen intake. So what is the working principle of BiPAP? That it maintains pressure while inhaling as well as exhaling. There is a lower pressure while exhaling, and while inhaling there is a higher pressure, hence making it easier to use than a CPAP machine. So we came up with this particular open source software and a microcontroller, Arduino based, and we made it an open source. You can read in this particular paper also. We have made a flowchart for it, and the software is freely available. It's an open source thing, and this can be easily used to vary the pressure from 5 to 30 centimeter of H2O, and it will not damage anybody's lung because the damaged lung limit is around 60 centimeter of H2O. Furthermore, we tried to use this single BiPAP machine if we can make it for four different patients, and we came up with a separator. We were seeing different videos of Italian doctors and how they are trying to combat their part of COVID-19, and they suggested such kind of ventilation separations. So these kind of filters, if they are attached to the separators, they avoid any cross-contamination between patients, while a single machine can be used for four different patients. Furthermore, we discussed that while choosing the mask for a patient, we have to test different masks. So Gaurav suggested, why don't we have a mask which can be universally fit to all patients? Still, we came up with two different sizes because some people have larger faces and some have smaller. So two separate sizes. We know if a person is smaller, we can have a small size fit and a larger size for a large size fit. So a foam and silicone coating was given just in order to have a close contact fit. Now let's come to our second problem. That is, during a pandemic, PPEs are usually under supply, and disposing them usually creates a lot of pollution, especially landfills and water pollution. So in these images, you can actually see how much pollution just from masks and gloves we are creating. So another of my research scholars, Kushagra, and I were discussing, and we came up with this idea, what can be the possible solution? So can we make these PPEs reusable? Although it is not recommended by WHO, but it is better than not having anything while contacting the patients. So how can we do it? First, we had to undergo proper literature survey. So we can use washing with detergent, which does not leave the spike proteins outside, and they no longer can contact with our nasal mucus supply. We can use disinfectants, which have 70% ethanol and 0.1% sodium hypochlorite solution. Then we can use the UVC radiation, around 254 nanometer one. We can use higher temperatures, above 56 degrees for more than 30 minutes. It has been stated that the coronavirus is no longer infected. Then we can use ultrasonification from 20 to 60 kilohertz for about 60 minutes. And we can also use antibacterial and antiviral effect depending upon different kind of oxidizing fumigation agents. So we brought together all these ideas from all this literature into one device. We wanted to give both options, wet and dry sterilization, by different these methods. And there is a non-contact sterilization. The machine cleans itself after each use. So the person who is putting in and taking out is not infected. So let me go back to my first slide again on the movie. And inspired by the real work and working in the real, when Kate said that the average person touches their face around 2,000 to 3,000 times a day. So again, I was discussing with Kushagra, and how can we remind ourselves not to touch mouth, nose, or eyes? And Kushagra's father suggested, why can't you do something to, you know, have that remind me I don't touch my face? So we came up with this add-on device to remember not to touch your eyes, mouth, nose. It can be attached to your normal specs, your face shield, or your mask, and you can have a choice whether to use light, vibration, or noise. And it is as low cost as just rupees 30, and that is less than 50 cents in USD. So this is Kushagra, who is demonstrating the use, and you can see that red light switching on when it comes near to his face. It's still a bit bulky, but we have reduced the size precisely since that time. These are quite old photos. So with this, I would like to thank my students, especially Kushagra, Hina, and Gaurav, who have been working throughout this pandemic. I would like to thank Subodh and the SWE organizers, our HOD, Dr. Ravi, Dr. Dheeraj, Dr. Asad. I would like to thank Professor Harpreet Singh, Javed Agrawala, and our director, Professor S.K. Das, who has been very supportive during this pandemic times. So if any young students are watching this, I would really like to suggest to you, scientific research needs independent thinking and hard work and not equipment. So please try to think and get inspired by your surroundings. And I'm sure you will get inspired. For any further information, please contact me, and welcome any questions from your side. Thank you.
Thank you, Neha. That was a really good webinar. I never thought Tech for Good can have so much purpose to it. It really was an eye-opener. So we'll move on to Dr. Kushbu for her research innovations to tackle COVID. Yes?
Am I audible?
Who you are?
Hello. So my name is Kushbu Rakha, as you can see on the screen. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Okay, so
go ahead, Kushbu.
So I'll start off with telling that in this process, after the lockdown, and we started a brainstorming session initiated by Dr. Dheeraj Mahajan in the campus, and the whole fraternity came together to bring out solutions. And in this process, what I've actually learned is how to bring an innovation to the market. So I'll take you through the steps of an innovation and how to commercialize it through what we have commercialized yet. So I'll start off with how to identify a problem. So COVID brings in many, many problems. The first thing is making a vaccine against it, the trials will take a long time. And there has been news, as already mentioned by Dr. Ekta and Dr. Neha, that we have to do social distancing. And there have been different news articles saying that, and even research articles saying that it can stay on inanimate objects for up to 5 days, up to 9 days. And that makes it very unpredictable. Also, it is uncommon in viruses to be so lethal, as well as spread so easily. So to reduce the spread, we focused on one problem. So the first step I would say is identification of a problem. You can do that by reading, by brainstorming, and really by discussion. So you can do discussion with people, and basically what the knowledge you're taking in, and then looking at a specific problem. The second, these are some of the problems we were looking at, that PPE is getting infected, like people are getting infected by PPE, health workers, it is really lethal to the health workers, especially, and there was a concern that whatever we are bringing inside our homes, even parcels, food, everything is getting infected. If everything might carry coronavirus, nobody knows what is carrying the virus. So the next step was to, after we do social distancing, what else can we do to stop it from spreading? So the next step to an innovation is ideation, or identifying an idea which can solve one of these problems. So once we have the problem statement, that is disinfection of spaces and inanimate surfaces to reduce the spread of COVID-19, the first step we took was for PPE, which involved ultrasonication UV light, but we wanted to really do what we could actually bring into the market immediately to save people from getting infected. So my father, Dr. Naresh Raka, who's also here, so he's a professor of preventive medicine, and he had extensive experience with using these laminar flow cleaning stations, cleaning benches, where there is a UV light, and after you have done your cell culture and everything, you turn on the UV light and leave the room, and everything gets disinfected up to 99.999%. So then we started looking into this technology, that can it be used at our homes. So then within ideation, there is screening and mapping of the current technology also. So in the present application, we wanted to map what is already being done. And we started looking through the literature. I'll mention here that the history of UVGI is quite old, which was a surprise to me also. It was first time it was reported in 1878. And there was a Nobel Prize that Niels Finsen won for using it for tuberculosis and lupus vulgaris. This was a time when antibiotics were not that freely available, were being researched, and UV was used to treat patients and to reduce the spread of the spread through hospitals. Then with the advent of antibiotics and everything, the use of UV in hospitals reduced, and it was first employed in a water treatment system in 1950. It was reported in 1910, but in 1950s they started using it very commonly in water treatment systems in Europe, and it is being used. Everyone at home has a RO system or a tent or AquaGuard water purifying system, and we have UV lights in them, high intensity UV lights. So it's very commonly used for water treatment. So one interesting use which I want to tell you about UVGI, as the first case at that time, human experiments were common, and there was a school in there was a school in Europe where they installed UV lights in the HVAC, so in the AC units, the central AC units of one of the wings of the school. When the measles season came back, only the half part, like there was a drastic difference in the number of students getting infected with measles from in the wing that did not have UVC lights installed and in the wing that had UVC lights installed. So there has been considerable research in this area, also amounting to the reduction of ozone that the current lamps are emitting. So UVGI technology is based on a specific wavelength of UV, which is from, can I get a, I'll just take a break to read about. Yeah, so UVC, UVA, B, C are the three types of wavelengths that even the sun emits are in our environment. Ozone, the ozone layer of Earth usually blocks the UVC, that is the lower wavelength, higher energy UV light. The effects, the germicidal effects have been in research from 1900s, and now it has been proven that this has germicidal effect, and there have mercury lamps which employ UVC of 254 nanometers are being used commonly in laboratories and water treatment centers, and similarly there are being, with the advent of optics and everything, there is people are researching LEDs made which can emit UV light, which will use much less of energy to emit the same radiation. So how UVC kills bacteria or viruses? So basically, exposure to electromagnetic radiation of UVC modifies the genetic material. Studies have demonstrated that a high degree of effectiveness of UVGI in activating coronaviruses, which cause diseases like SARS and MERS. So there has been considerable study on SARS and MERS. At present, right now, there is no reported study, no published study that it kills COVID-19. But because that there have been comparisons made between COVID-19 and the earlier coronaviruses, which are of the same family and have a similar structure, similar size, they're yes, they are bigger than the other viruses, but they have a similar size amongst themselves, and they are basically single-stranded RNA viruses. So thus, it is like, so they'll break the RNA system, make dimers of them, and basically these viruses then cannot reproduce even if a person is exposed to them. So they are inactivated. So next was to how to use this. So the first thing we did was proof of concept or prototyping. So proof for prototyping, we had really limited resources. Labs are not open. We cannot go to labs. We cannot purchase things right now. It was a complete lockdown situation. This was in end of February, end of March, where the lockdown had just started. And we just took our household trunk. We had an old water purifier. So it is known that UVC light radiation that is coming from so what you see here is a blue light, that is not UVC. So UVC light radiation becomes less and less with time. So we took for calculations, we took only 10% efficiency coming out, and we made the calculations. We used aluminium foil, using just a household aluminium foil, and a lot of enthusiasm to make this product, this prototype at home. So this was our proof of concept. And once we had the proof of concept, we put it on social media directly, that if anybody, manufacturer wants and everything. The next step was to make the actual product. So once we have a proof of concept, the next step would be the commercialization. So we did some mathematical modeling where we took into account the wavelength of the UV light being emitted from a lamp, the radiation flux, the distance from the UVC source, which makes a huge difference in the dose required, time required, the UVC susceptibility of the pathogen. So if you notice this curve, there is the UVC susceptibility doesn't stay constant. So there is a there is a rate at which the pathogens will reduce. So if I have 100% pathogen load at till some time, so you can think of it as two different populations. One is more susceptible to UVC and the other is less susceptible. So we model that into a mathematical model from which we can we have developed this model, and we can help calculate the time required for desired microbial log reduction. And this study has been done with so many papers that we have. So we have incorporated all the doses, all the research that has been done on viruses, on all types of pathogens, and then specifically on coronaviruses, averaging out the values and taking conservative values, so that we are taking the highest value possible to kill COVID-19. So now the next step is, so we have all this, we have a mathematical model, we have a prototype which we are using, but now we have to bring it to the market, because the aim was to bring it to masses. So now this is the main step. If we have a technology, we need to put it into a design that can reach masses. So good design is required to take a very good technology out of our lab to the masses. That is a right mix of the design and technology. So we designed different products and we are working with companies. So this is a product we had designed for a specific company, and where we have done the UV arrangement, the calculation, the overall calculation and everything. So to get the highest effectiveness, 360 degree exposure. So it is important to understand that if a surface is not exposed to UVC light, it would not get disinfected. So shadowing, it has to be considered, and we lined it with a UV reflective coating, and now we already have this product ready. So commercially, so the first trunk design was also modified into having a 360 degree sanitization, and we have signed 3 non-exclusive MOUs on that device, which by the way are free. So if you are interested in a MOU, but our only, so IIT Roper's only condition was that because we have made it for good and for the masses, the companies who are taking this MOU from us will keep minimal profit out of it. So they also have to work for good. And then we are collaborating with other manufacturers to bring in other disinfecting units. So these are box type again. So both of these are already made and are available in market. And we are making area sterilizers area sterilizers, conveyor belts. So we are working on this. We are modeling for different products soon you'll see them in market. So the process is going on. So another product that was the government of India has institutions that health workers getting infected is a major problem. So we came out with this concept of a doffing station, which is an ideal place where. Concept of a doffing station, which is an ideal place for health workers to take off their PPE. So the CDC, WHO, Indian Medical Association, they all have given a protocol to remove PPE. Doffing basically means removal of personal protective equipment. So right now that we have contacted many doctors, and they were basically going to a corner of a room, and within the patient room, just going to the corner near the door, taking off their PPE, leaving them there in a bin, and coming out. This, and the next person was going at the same place. And this place was being cleaned once or twice a day with chemical surfactants. And it was seen that many healthcare workers were getting infected. So this was an immediate need that we have designed and given to the government. And we are also working on prototyping it with the company. So basically it has three complementary technologies: chemical disinfection, that is the tunnel. If you can see this image, so a person comes through a disinfection tunnel. It can be built, it can be modified into any hospital room, a small room, 10 by 10 feet room or smaller, or it can be, and what we are working on with the company is to make it as a standalone unit that can be it will be mobile and it will be placed outside or just near to the patient room. So I'll again explain. Donning is when you wear PPE. That is usually done in a clean room near office spaces and not near the patient's room. It is not that critical because at that time you're clean, the PPE is clean. And once you enter the patient room, you are catering to people who have coronavirus. And whatever precautions you take, there is a very high pathogen load in that area, and there is a very high chance that there will be a high pathogen load on the surfaces that you are touching, and thus on your own personal protective equipment. So now removal of this PPE becomes a major issue. So what we have designed is we have made these three complementary technologies. First, it will be chemical disinfection. Definitely a chemical disinfection through a tunnel won't reach all places. So we have added a negative pressure. Dr. Dheeraj Mahajan has been working on negative pressure, and he has built a brilliant product with the negative pressure technology. And he has also done modeling of what pressure and how it will be reached and everything. So so we as a team are working on it, and it will have a negative pressure to whatever pathogens go into the air are basically sucked out of the room. And we have done a modeling for UVGI. So the main features of this disinfection tunnel we have recommended an antimicrobial compound available at IIT Roopat for the disinfection tunnel. There are also some WHO recommended chemicals which can be used in the disinfection tunnel. There are bins for discarded and reusable PPE. So if you can see here, there is a bin one, bin two, where we can place our reusable. Both use UVGI technology for a preliminary disinfection. So so before the removal by another health worker, because then that health worker is at risk. So we have provided those bins. The negative pressure of maintaining a negative pressure will significantly lower the risk of viruses, which we have, Korea has seen this model, has worked on this model, and a negative pressure will basically have the flow of air in a direction where anyone coming into a room where the pathogen is already there will not get infected. So, and then of course we have done a modeling of this for this doffing station with the arrangement and specifications of UVC type germicidal lamps for effective sterilization. And for this, we really require something that goes up to 99.99% reduction. So just to revise, steps to a useful innovation are identification of a specific problem, conceptualization of the problem, and conceptualization requires all the reading of the last, 100 years, 60 years of papers, and then bringing out a model or bringing out something that you can find a solution to. Then there is a proof of concept, prototyping, and once the prototyping is done, you can say that designing a finished product should be before prototyping, but that is usually in proof of concept, the first prototype is not the actual thing that would reach commercialization. So now we have to screen scalability and what is required by the public, whether they need it in offices, they need it at their homes. So then as faculty in IIT, this is where we collaborate with industries, and this is where industries collaborate with us, that we design a finished product, and then it reaches the masses. So the final step is commercialization. Thank you.
Thank you, Kushboo. Thank you for letting us know commercial concepts to help curb this COVID. We have few questions. I know we have delayed like 10 minutes, but it's just three questions and I'll just go ahead. This question is for Dr. Ekta. Just a minute.
Yeah, please tell me, but it's not
visible. Yes, Ekta. So what Ashish Patel asked is, how WordBot connect with IoT technology?
Okay, yes, these days, because we know that everybody looks for how to increase the automation to connect with the artificial intelligence, right? But yes, as I said that these our first job was to come out with the structure, which was mechanical in nature, and enough of sensors, which is not yet can be said as IoT, had been already planned. But once you know that anything, with, because once we think of like how to make it more intelligent, then the systems, then all that, because, you know, particularly its application can be in the wards itself, where where in the different wards it can actually plan, and we can think of the entire the path structure of the ward itself through the clouds, I mean through the information which is available, and we can think of implanting or, you know, deploying any robotic system, which can be, say, IPAC for you, I send to a particular hospital and the skills are not required in that particular hospital, and the person there can just connect us with their using the video, they can connect us to the hospital plan, and there the IoT will be helpful. But yes, to make it cost effective, at present we have not yet tried, but there is enough of like, you know, potential to add such things.
Nice that we got a answer to add new feature to our WordBot. And Ashish also asked, like, there are many manufacturing jobs which might replace by robots in future. What's your opinion on this?
In fact, thank you, Ashish, to ask this, because, you know, it's not about just answering it, but it's my own, my connect with robotics, because I am into this area from the last more than 15 years. And every time I'm getting the question, particularly when I was doing even my PhD, that why we are working in robotics when in India it's not, you know, applicable and you have to go beyond. Because I remember people used to say, don't you want to work in India? You are looking for outside, I mean, the foreign jobs. And this was the scenario, and this is a scenario today. So but now looking at such cases, I am sure. And that's why I mentioned during my presentation that I'm glad to see that change very soon. So even if this change has come in these adversities, I mean, that's the bad point. But people have seen that how automation at less cost also, the robotic systems can be brought for different situations. And that is why, rather than just working for COVID-19, rather than that, I would like to present these ideas in such a way so that people can see the utility. Not me, like-minded all. And similarly, in industries, already they were in use. But the change, Ashish, is not only for, you know, it will be coming from the globally imported ones to the indigenous. Already there are, I would say, 10 to 15 or maybe more, increasingly number for the robotic industries are coming up in India. And soon you will find that its deployment, even at the simple sectors, even at our homes. Because it was looking like far off, but now you will see the change very soon. And the Indians, you know, they learn very fast. The skills will come very fast. Yes. So, yeah, I'm glad to see the change. Yeah.
Yeah, glad for the question, Ashish. This question is from Anjali. She asks, like, can the WordBot, which you designed, has the capability to take scans of the patients?
Sorry.
Can it take the scan of the patients?
Okay, yes. I would say it can be utilized, because that is why I said autonomous, and this is the basic design, and it can be customized as per requirement. So in case somebody has to go look for a scanner, only thing is the end effector as a scanner needs to be employed on the robotic system. And after that, either using remote control, or as I said, autonomous. So in this, remote control will be better, because you need some kind of some kind of you know, a fine tuning at the end, because where the scan is required. So yes, further end effect will be required to be attached to the BotBot. Already we are working for modular robotic arms, because I work with robot modular systems, so that over the you know, a base of that particular BotBot, can we attach extra arms for different such jobs. So a BotBot itself will not be helpful, but you have to attach some at least three degrees of freedom arm over it for any such task, and then it will be used for any such task like scanning or and using the IoT, it can be scanned anywhere. Like you are scanning here and the doctors can see anywhere. So these things are already in use for different purposes, and now it can be attached to this.
Interesting. Sheila Sharda asked, like, are the systems easy to operate, and will there be any maintenance issues for the BotBot?
Oh, yes, there will be. Her point is very, very valid from the practical perspective. And we had done some calculations already that, first of all, what comes, you know, expensive is not just the capital amount, but yes, the maintenance, because first comes the batteries. And you have to always look for, like, how long it can work, and when you need to renew it, when you need to, you know, revive it. And other things are, of course, all the sensors. But, you know, it's like all the gadgets which we are using these days. So for the time being, the cost is not the issue, because for the time being, health hazards, they come. There we say that even if it is expensive or not. But very soon, I'm sure that we'll be looking for the once it will be in the market, and you can always see the better technologies for reducing prices as well as the maintenance system. So it will not be very much, but yes, for batteries and sensors are anyway least expensive. And we are making it modular, you know. This modular will help, because you can replace any component easily, because the structure is like this. You need not to change the entire. So there it will be helpful to make it less expensive to maintain.
Got it. This question is for Dr. Khushbu. We know the situation of pandemic might get normalized, but in that case, do we need to change over on a big scale based on the tech you have shown? It seems like it's pretty hard to understand. Yeah.
So the thing is, this technology can be used directly in the food industry. So when we receive fruits or food from outside, there are already bacteria, viruses on them. So it's not only focused on COVID-19. If you're talking about this particular technology, it is already being used and can be further exploited to be to different industries. Also, we have to be careful. Right now, I'm thinking of the movie Dr. Neha's told before touching my face. So we really have to be cautious of our moves, where we are going, and whatever we are bringing in. So it will drastically, like, it will bring a drastic difference in our lifestyles also, and it would be that drastic difference would be for good. But as such, the about the products, yes, they will be useful after this pandemic goes, and I hope the pandemic goes away very soon. But we are still looking at a long timeline. It is a very long timeline. But for future, we have to secure ourselves from future pandemics, for future epidemics. And in general, we are bringing food from outside, which has bacteria or things from outside. So the general health can be improved by these products also.
Another question for Dr. Khushbu from Sheila Sharda. Where have you installed these systems? Have they been installed?
Okay, so the box type products are already in market. You can find them on Amazon, on Gem, online, or you can contact these people. Other than that, we are working on an area sterilizer, and that is basically aimed at for offices. Within the AC units, and like a portable or a robot. So we have not yet added robotics, but now I have a very good idea, and I'll just call Dr. Ekta and ask her to add some robotics to it. So that is an area sterilizer. And currently these boxes are already there, and even IIT Ropar is buying some of these box types. And so it's basically for parcels, whatever you are receiving from outside. So there are some things. UV is very I should have added a disclaimer. It's very harmful for human beings. So if we look at it directly, it can cause temporary blindness. It is very harmful for our skin. So exposure, so when we are using UV, either we keep it out of sight of people, out of exposure, or we use it at a time when there is no human exposure. So designing a product, we really have to focus on where to install these UV lights, and there should be zero leakage of this radiation to human beings.
I have a question for Neha, Dr. Neha. So I was thinking, you were mentioning about the tech where we can wear, which will inform us not to touch our nose and eyes, right?
So I need
wouldn't
that.
Same in a way, but like, wouldn't it be very inconvenient because not a lot of us are wearing masks in correct way, even though it's a simple technology.
That is true. It is difficult to have and get used to something. It is very difficult. Yeah. But something, if something is saving you, something inconvenient is saving you, you still wear the N95 mask, right? Because precaution is better than cure.
True. Makes sense. Thank you for the beautiful session, and thank you, Dr. Ekta, Dr.
Kushal, for organizing it. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And we'll be having a small feedback survey post this webinar, and we'll be sending you key takeaways and contact IDs of our speakers, just in case if you want to add any further suggestions for them. And thank you all for attending. Do follow us on our social media. Be safe, be healthy. Bye.
Thank you, Sunan.